Welcome everybody to this next talk. In this talk, I'm going to present my Hitchhiker's Guide to Cloud Native Build Pipelines and Infrastructure as Code. In this talk, I will cover four topics. First, start with Cloud Native Pipelines and compare them with Infrastructure as Code. I will look at the meaning and the importance in DevOps practices and also the difference in tooling. The second topic that I just is like we're going to explore how you can do infrastructure as code using the best of breed tools like Terraform, Ansible, and Packer. The third topic, I will look at cloud native build pipelines and how you can use Visual Builder Studio to like use and run the infrastructure as code definitions. Terraform, Ansible, and Packer. And lastly, I will go over a getting started guide for infrastructure as code on the Oracle Cloud. Look at some demo resources for provisioning of the infrastructure through pipelines. So, my name is Robert van Moeke. I'm a solution architect and developer at Amis in the Netherlands. I focus there on blockchain, Internet of Things, and cloud applications. I'm a Groundbreaker Ambassador and Oracle Ace. And in the past years, I wrote two books, one about implementing Oracle Integration Cloud Service, and the most recent one about blockchain across Oracle, and mostly on the industries, the impact for the customers, and but also how to implement a real use case and how you use blockchain cloud service for that. If you want to follow, you can do that through LinkedIn or my blog or Twitter at Robert van Moeke. So let's head over and explore cloud native build pipelines versus infrastructure as code. So before I go into the details, I take a step back and look at DevOps itself. I think everybody has seen this picture, is that with DevOps we want to merge the developers and the operations in one and the same team, and that you don't have to wait a long time and you work together, where a developer normally does the planning of what's need to be built, then code, then really build the artifacts, test it, and then you go through the integration of deployments through operations, operating, and a monitor, and this is something that's come together. In this whole process, a lot of automation. And we see in the last years that you really, with the infrastructure, and now we're running in the cloud and the applications running on this infrastructure, you want to spin up easily, very quickly in a new environment. Even these two profiles need to work more and more together from really the start of the project. Around automation and DevOps, I want to go over five practices that I think will be a little bit of the we'll see with infrastructure as code and CI/CD and pipelines that that these are really important practices I think around it. So the first one is configuration management, and what we mean with configuration management is like we want to automate like tedious tasks. If you everyday tasks that are constantly the same, and maybe you need to import a load from CSV to a database, or you need to install software, you need to do patching and updates, and with configuration management, it allows your organization to really increase their agility. And mostly here, I'm gonna touch base on software installations. Now, infrastructure as code. What we mean with that is that we want to turn complex systems and environments into just a few lines of code. And these files are human readable and can easily be changed, and you can see the changes. And it enables deployment through CI/CD pipelines. And with this, we can provision like the new cloud environments. On extension of that is if you look at infrastructure as code and maybe even everything as code, one of the important ones that I use in projects is documentation as code. And with this, we want to also automate the documentation along with the written code. So this can be in more things like Markdown or ASCII doc, but you create documentation and usually technical documentation alongside the code for developers' operations, everybody that's involved in the project. With the, yeah, instead of having Word documents that you share or want to edit and need to do version control, yeah, you can step over to this. And you can see changes in the Git repository happening and what's changed in documentation. Now, if you have infrastructure as code and documentation as code, you want to automate it. First, we have continuous integration. And this is like the process of managing our code lifecycle. And we do this by automating the build and testing of code. And every time a team member commits changes to version control. So that's our start. And maybe we have some infrastructure as code scripts, we check it in, and then it's going to be built. And then we have continuous delivery, and this is the process of managing the application deployments. We did the build, code is ready, chuck, and then test it, configure things, and then deploy it from even like development to production. That's the whole process around it. So let's look at the meaning of infrastructure as code itself. And infrastructure as code itself, if we talk about that, we mean the managing and the provisioning of IT, in this case, cloud infrastructure, through machine readable files. That's why we call it code. And rather than we do manual processes and have like a Word document that says, oh, you need to do this, you need to do that, all these things. It needs to be this shape, it needs to be on this location. And these files can either be scripts, can be bash, can be PowerShell, or it are declarative definitions. And I always now try to propose on the provisioning of infrastructure is to go to the declarative definitions. And these definitions, they can comprise of both physical equipment, like bare metal servers, as well as cloud resources, such as virtual machines, but also platform services, application services, database, functions as a service, and associated configuration resources, networking, it's like the firewalls, storage, these things that come together. These definitions are stored in the same version control as application code. It's different repository, but it uses the same the same system. Usually, it's Git. It's these definitions are used by the tools to perform unattended automation. So, the scripts, you start them, and they run all the work. And these tools also do state management, which means if something already is run or something is already in the state it needs to be, then it can skip these tasks to do. And that's a little bit of what is infrastructure as code. If you look at the benefits, is that with infrastructure as code, we can easily do automation of server updates. Not only the automation on new servers or resources, but also automation on existing ones. So the benefits of infrastructure code and automation is that we can easily synchronize the configuration between environments by running these definitions files. Even on a schedule, you can say, okay, this and this need the changes need to be executed. And it can create immutable servers, which then it applies the changes by only rebuilding servers. So this means if you need to be careful, if you already have an environment running and your application running on it, and then you do infrastructure as code, it's possible that It rebuilds the surface, so you lose some things that are on it. So if you do this, the impact can be that you remove already running things. You can also create containerized servers. So, and it's a little bit better if you have you apply changes by deploying a container. If you have a service on Kubernetes or something like that, you can do that too. With the infrastructure as code, because it's code, you can reuse and promote these definitions. And you can reuse the same definition fast across environments for both application or servers or infrastructure, the hardware, everything. So the benefit of it is that if you have like some cookbook, some manifold files, some templates, Ansible code and playbooks, you can really, can reuse them through dev, stage, and prod, and that you know that all your environments are the same. I already mentioned this, unattended automation. So if the tools and the infrastructure code, they run on a schedule, they can apply or reapply or update any configuration. If you do it like that, and you change the code and you update and run it, you really can also discover problems very quickly. So if there's like a server is running, you do an update and something happens and something doesn't work, you can easily check back what is run or not run. But also this unattended automation will check, validates changes and if it runs these changes. But what it does, because it's infrastructure as code and it is in your Git repository, force yourself to fix those problems before you can promote them to a new environment. And but also to improve the process. If somebody just does a manual step and then you do a reapply and boom, the environment, something is missing, then yeah, you improve also the process. Okay, if you change something on the environment, you need to do infrastructure as code. So this really just encourages these changes and forcing you to really have those updates in the definition first. It's forcing you that the definition is the truth. And with this, it's always good also to test these infrastructure files. So always test and plan these new changes before applying to platform DevOps. So with this, you can first do infrastructure as code on info test environment. And if that is correct, then you can say, okay, we have a dev test and go to production with our application sources. Explain infrastructure as code. We also have cloud native pipelines on the other side. CI/CD pipelines, they are CI/CD pipelines for cloud native applications. Applications that have and our resources run in the cloud. Applications can run on Kubernetes or virtual machines or anything. But these are like CI/CD pipelines that provide us like this functionality. So these CI/CD pipelines, they build the code. It can be so the infrastructure, it can be application, and they do that on a commit trigger. Somebody puts it something in it. Then it validates the infrastructure definition or this application code, and then it creates and archives these deployment artifacts. They normally do that in a registry. It can be a Docker registry. It can be an Artifactory, but things that are built successfully, they are written to a registry. And then the tools are run, and they take this validated and deployed artifact, and they run the changes, and they run these files applying the changes to environments. And it also only promotes after passing the test and authorization. So every time we validate, we do the infrastructure deployment, and then we need to run test them and promote them, right? These pipelines, they are built like that to run these steps. So what the benefits of these pipelines are is that you validate and test change, right? The pipelines, they validate before any, before even changes to production, right? So with this, because you run the pipelines, things are changing, you get the confidence also for frequent and small improvements. It also limits direct changes to infrastructure and application configuration, because everything needs to go through these pipelines. And if you, for example, make changes, it can be nullified if this pipeline runs again. You also know the correctness about applied changes, because you see what happens in the pipeline, you see what's executed and when it's not executed. If you make a mistake in the files, the pipeline validates it. Can be like say, okay, this is wrong. Right. And it also guarantees the same performance, because you reuse and reapply these infrastructure definitions, but also the code. Yeah, so you know that with these pipelines, if you do it step by step and you only promote things if correct, you can really guarantee the performance and stability across your environment. And other thing is that it really makes the governance a little bit easy, because the process of applying changes is auditable. You mentioned that you make a change in the Git repository, you can see what changes are made, because it's code, right? It's human readable. You can see the difference between them. And you know that because you automate these things, you know that the processes you discuss between ops and development, they are followed. Some build step can require authorization if it's needed. So it's a good thing about these pipelines. So what tools can we use? So here we have both, again, the infrastructure as code and the cloud native build pipelines. So for infrastructure as code, I think most of you in the past used things maybe like Puppet and Chef and SaltStack. These are the ones that use an agent. You need to install an agent on a VM, and then this agent collects resources at the central point and then executes what it needs to be done. Then where we are now looking at are Terraform, Ansible, and Packer. These kind of configuration definitions, and instead of need to run something on the host itself, it runs in the build pipelines, and then it applies the changes, and it applies the changes to the cloud resources. So for cloud native build pipelines, we had tools already that could do pipelines, right? Jenkins, Circle CI, and Bamboo. These things are using, they don't include things like Git. They don't include a lot of tools, right? They have a specific thing to run pipelines as shell scripts. And it was mostly focused still on on-premise, right? When they started, you can use Jenkins and even the newer Jenkins X, of course, also to do these pipelines. But I want to look at the other three. Here these new ones like Oracle Visual Builder Studio, Azure DevOps, and GitLab. They have everything included. They have the Git included. They have the pipe slides included. They have the project planning included. This is a little different caliber of than maybe Bamboo, Jenkins, and Circle CI. So specifically call them here separately. And what I mentioned is the Git and the Docker, they are like part of these kind of tooling. You need them. And with Visual Builder Studio, DevOps, and GitLab, they are part of it. If you go to Jenkins, Bamboo, you need to really also install these things. But you always use like Git and Docker in this principle. So in this presentation, I want to focus on with infrastructure code, like I said in the introduction, Terraform, Ansible, and Packer, and for cloud native build pipelines, Oracle Visual Builder Studio. Now, with all these tools, it doesn't matter which cloud provider you use. You can do the Oracle Cloud, Azure, Amazon. You can even do local private cloud things, but it doesn't really matter because they are cloud agnostic. Okay. Next up, a little bit deep dive, explore a little bit further about the infrastructure as code and using Terraform, Ansible, and or Packer. So it can be a combination, it can be separately. Let's first explore Terraform. So Terraform is a tool where you can write, plan, and create infrastructure as code. And the tool does it by tracking the state of the infrastructure and that it manages. And Terraform works in a declarative, with a declarative approach. So the configuration files that you define are written in declarative way, where you define the expected state. You don't specify the sequence of actions, like CLI. And these configuration files can be written in ACL or optional in JSON. ACL stands for HashiCorp Configuration. It is, I will show you an example in the next slide. It looks like JSON, but it has its own its configuration language to instruct Terraform. So Terraform manages virtual server lifecycles, VMs, also supporting services, like I said, networking, storage, firewalls, but also platform services. Can be communities, can be databases, can be functions, what the cloud service offers, that usually can be managed with Terraform. Now, Terraform supports a diverse range of cloud providers and also the tools. And it does it through a set of plugins called providers. And they include Oracle Cloud, Azure, but also applications like Helm, Logic Monitor. So it's not only cloud providers, but it's also tooling, cloud tooling, also local tooling. So Terraform, for example, here can use the OCI provider, and that talks to the REST APIs on the cloud. So Terraform uses ACL configuration files, and this is an example of a compute instance on OCI. And you see here that you have a resource definition, and it's a block of data. And the header of this definition always has a type name structure. Here we have a resource, the type is an OCI core instance, and the name what we want to give it when it's created. So we create here a vesting VM. Now you have some attributes, they can reference variables. Like here, variable compartment ID underscore OC ID. This means this is somewhere already defined in some host configuration, or we know this in the environment. Variable, and you see also here you can have availability domains. Then we have that attributes can also reference resources. So if we already have an OCI running, or this resource is running, so an OCI core subnet is also something you can create. But here the OCI is a core subnet is referenced. Have created one. It's like the Bastion AD net subnet, and then we ask the ID from. You can also reference file paths. Like here, we reference an SSH authorization key. With this key, you will be able to connect to the SSH of this VM. So in addition, the resource can depend on each other, like we already seen. The OCI core subnet is used here. And when you run this thing, this configuration in Terraform, it builds a graph and it knows how to track dependencies, what's already there, what's needed, and then it executes only the resources in the order it can do. But Terraform can also perform actions in parallel. So if there's no dependency, it can choose to execute things in parallel. For example, if you want two VMs, different VMs. Now, besides Terraform, there's also another tool in infrastructure as code world that's Ansible. And it's by Red Hat, also open source, but Red Hat is one of the main contributors. And Ansible is an IT automation and orchestration tool. And this tool is very popular because it's very its simplicity for automation of software installation. So it can configure systems, it can just like Terraform and create cloud. But the main power is also the deployment of software and the orchestration. If you need to do very advanced IT tasks, and you want continuous deployments, and you want to do that with zero downtime and rolling updates, really Ansible is a good tool for that. Ansible doesn't use any agents, so if you look at the Puppet and Chef, we needed to do that. Ansible doesn't need to an agent to be installed on the target machine. It uses SSH to get information from the remote servers and also to run commands and also on these remote servers, and even copying files between your build by a pipeline server and your target host. Ansible uses has it it's modular and according to plugins modules, it uses some kind of inventories where you have your configurations of your hosts and playbooks. Playbooks is important here, and this makes it a little bit it makes it a perfect tool to orchestrate really large environments. And usually Ansible is for installing software on a virtual machine, where Terraform is really there to provision your cloud environment. And if you have a virtual machine, you can use Ansible to really do the configuration management on this virtual machine. So this is the architecture of Ansible. And you have, it doesn't matter, it can be a public and private cloud where you want to run these configurations on or provision things or want to install things. All these configurations can be in the CMDB. But you have users, and users define playbooks. These playbooks are also stored eventually in the inventory. So the inventory describes the information where things need to go to. Collects it from the CMDB. Then a playbook, that's a unit of scripts that defines the work and the place for server configuration. It's a YAML format. That's why you can easily put it in Git and you can track the changes. But a playbook really does describes what task needs to be done, and it uses modules for that. And the modules and the plugins are the things that actually do the work. And these modules get executed each time a playbook task is executed. Ansible is written purely in Python, so all the things are executed in Python interpreter. Eventually, also the modules and the plugins are all written in Python. If you want to create your own plugin, that's possible. Do it in Python. And these plugins can create hosts, but you can also put things on. Install the service on this host. You can use Ansible without Terraform, so because Terraform also has plugins to do things on cloud providers and also create VMs, instances, and things like that. But with Terraform, you can do much more. You can have also these supporting supporting services and also the platform services. As a more support from the cloud providers, like on Terraform for these things then on Azure. So this is an example of an Ansible playbook to install Redis on a host. And so what you do is you say, okay, this needs to be executed on this host. Now we want to install Redis, on which port, how many databases, and also the tasks the playbook needs to do. And what I said, every task is like a Python command. So it can be that you want to check if Redis service is available, you want to install it to Apt, you want to start the service, and do some configuration. And then at the end, you want to restart the server so that everything is up and running. Then a third tool, which is very interesting, is Packer. Packer is a tool for creating machine and container images that can for multiple platforms from just a single source configuration. So if you use Terraform to create your VM on the cloud, then you need to supply usually a base image. And what you can do is like, okay, use Ansible to perform these tasks on this VM host. But if you need to do it a lot of times, then with Packer, you can create machine images, container images, with already the Ansible, for example, software. And it can install the software on this image and use this image as a base image for provisioning your infrastructure or your virtual machine in the cloud. So this machine image is a single static unit, and it contains all the pre-configured operating systems and also the installed software, which is used to quickly create new running instances on the cloud. Packer installs and configures all the software for the machine at the time the image is built. So you start this build pipeline for Packer, and this image is built and it's put in your registry. And after it's built, you can choose to launch or destroy it. So Packer just creates the image. It doesn't do anything with it itself. That's why in combination with Terraform or Ansible, you can do things with this image. Mostly it's here Terraform that can use this image to create a new instance. If you now Packer can create identical images for multiple platforms, so it can be on Oracle Cloud for example production, or use a private cloud in staging, or even for development you can use VirtualBox. And each environment it's running an identical machine image. So Packer has a workflow, and you see here a little bit of how it goes. So you have templates, they are JSON files which contain the build information that needs to happen. Then you have builders, these are platform specific builder configuration. So the template will build it, and from the build, provision. So, and provisioners are the tools that install the software after the initial OS is installed. Then you also have post-processing, and post-processing are actions that happen after the image has been built. It can maybe be that you want to create an image that's just on disk, or you want to have like a virtual box. But after the build, you want to maybe put it in a zip file, make it smaller. You can use post processes for that. And then this image can be put on Oracle Cloud, Azure, VirtualBox, VMware, OpenStack, depending on what you build the image for. So this is a template example for creating an image that can be used on OCI, and it has a few data blocks. It is like the same as Ansible and the same as like Terraform. There's a certain structure. Here it's JSON, and the template can define reusable variables, both static and also from an environment. And they can also be used in the rest of the template, like here, which you reference like with a user-defined variable. Then you have the builder block itself, and the builder block defines one or more build configurations for creating images. This is just one kind of image, but you can but depending on the type, here it's Oracle OCI, you can create a target, the targets that you want. OCI, it can also be Azure, Docker, just a local file, VMware, VirtualBox, anything. And every builder has its own parameters. For example, for the tenancy in this case, it defines the base image, the VMware shape, my SSH username and password, which it needs to use. And at the bottom part, you see the provisioners. And this block defines one or more actions to perform on the OS itself. And in this, and what you do, which provisioner you use, is you specify that in the type. It can be shell, PowerShell, file, puppet, also directly Ansible, directly Terraform. You can do these things. Here, it's an example of shell, and you see every shell command is like in this JSON, like written down as a. Every line is its own command. And this command, these here, install software with apt. It uses SDKman, and from there it installs Java and Maven on this machine. So it can, for example, be a developer base image where we have Java and Maven running on it. So that's the tooling we use for infrastructure as code. Terraform, Ansible, and Packer, three tools really to look at, and even use in combination. Use Packer to make the good base images. These base images, you can even configure them with Ansible. So you create a Packer image that runs a playbook, and this base image is then, if you provision your environment with Terraform, you can select this base image as the starting point of your virtual machine or your compute on Oracle Cloud. Now let's look at cloud native pipelines using Oracle Visual Builder Studio, formerly known as Developer Cloud. So Visual Builder Studio is a service that integrates all the agile collaborative teams, the whole DevOps mentality, the DevOps practices. It has code management, does CI/CD automation, and also this version, what Developer Cloud didn't do, was you can extend really the visual development. They have tooling for that for web and mobile applications. Visual Builder Studio for us, and certainly for the context of this presentation, is that it manages the full life cycle of all the artifacts, and that participate in the ecosystem. Can be any Oracle Cloud application, can be infrastructure, can be anything. So it includes features to streamline our development lifecycle. For the whole Agile part, the issue tracker, the Agile board, sprint management. But also along with that, we have a wiki for sharing information. We have the private Git repositories to start these things with, so we can store our data in our own Git repositories and our project, and that's our starting place, right? We commit our infrastructure as code definitions and also our application code to the Git repositories that are supplied by Visual Builder Studio. And it really integrates very well with popular build and test frameworks, so you can choose there also with Java, the test tools with npm, Docker, the registry, all these things, also. We need use the build frameworks for that, and utilities to help us manage the infrastructure as code, and standards such as Docker, Kubernetes, and Terraform. So if you go to Visual Builder Studio and you create your first project, this is what you see. We get the agile boards. We have even the binary repository for our artifacts. And we can do the build to code. This is like the big one. So this is also for the web and mobile development. You see that you can do even components, store. We have Maven, we have NPM. We can do merge requests, we can have define even environments, we have a Docker running, even mobile builds. So it has all these features to really help us manage our lifecycle of all our applications. So some highlights here, we have some project templates. You can create empty projects or like an initial repository with a README. You can import projects, Git repositories from different things. If you have something in GitHub already or GitLab and you want to like migrate, you can easily import projects. You can create private repositories that you need to have a private key to log into. Also use like IDCS to connect. And you can also create application extensions and even visual applications like with Visual Builder for web and mobile applications. So there's some starter templates you can choose. Other thing is like in this version is that you can have project environments. You can say, okay, a development, acceptance, production, and also which cloud services it uses. Platform services, for example. So if you do infrastructure as code, you don't have this, but what you do is like normally you have infrastructure as code pipelines and you have application pipelines. And the infrastructure as code can create these kind of applications and update and patch these. And then we have our development. And then, for example, if we provision a Kubernetes engine, we can have this here that we know we can deploy Docker containers containers to Kubernetes. It has deep Git integration, so you can see the differences. You can also see the blames. You can do code reviews. Merge requests, all these things, and all in a nice editor. A cloud editor where you can change these files and see what's wrong. You can do conflict management. And of course, CI/CD pipelines, where it all goes around to look for this in our context of this presentation. Here you see an image of a configured step. If you wanted to Terraform, you need to Unix shell where you can run this example of Terraform, but you can add a lot of steps. Docker, you can create all the steps for the login and pulling images and do all the Docker things, but you can do also FN for functions and servers. If you want to build your node application, if you do want to log in and do things on SQL, if you want to do things on OCI, but also specific things for visual applications and application extensions. You have a lot of build steps that you can directly build here and create your pipeline. And lastly, I want to give you some getting started on Oracle Cloud guides and some references to it. I don't have any time anymore to go them over detail, but here are some links in the slide deck to get you started. Like the Terraform provider for Oracle Cloud Infrastructure, and also the Git repository to get some examples. How the builder works for Packer, for OCI, getting started with Ansible on Oracle Cloud, and also how you do that on GitHub. And then really two guides to get started, infrastructure as code using Terraform, and build custom images with Packer on Oracle Cloud. So I really suggest to go over them. So with Terraform, you have the provider, you can do platform stuff like API gateway, digital assistant, but also for things the compute, auto scaling, everything's there. A lot of examples you can find on GitHub for that. For OCI builder, we find the same thing on Packer. all the instructions, all the things you need to do. But of course, the example was already in my presentation earlier. How to use the Ansible modules, and then the two guides for infrastructure's code, and also the images. So thanks for being here. Thanks for listening to me. I hope you learned something. I'm a part of the Groundbreaker Ambassador. If you want to nominate somebody, you can do that to gbanomination.oracle.com. So with this, I want to conclude my presentation. Thanks all for coming, and hope to see you in another presentation soon.